1963, Africa made history with the foundation of the Organization of African Unity. And of course, this is a very important day, and it was a precursor to what we now know as the African Union. Now, the day, of course, is observed annually, and it calls for us to take stock and really reflect on how far Africa has come in its fight against colonialism. We celebrate Africa's strong cultural identity, common heritage. It's not only about the clothes that we are wearing that define us as African, and also looking at the fact that this is quite an important day when it comes to the African continent. We're also reflecting, of course, on the challenges, on apartheid, on colonialism, and looking at the challenges that still lie ahead for Africa, and how important is it going to be for these to be addressed. And of course, this year's theme is looking at the importance of addressing malnutrition and food insecurity in Africa. And this, of course, is happening as even that meeting in Ghana is also looking at issues around food security. So certainly a lot to you know, think about and really to mull over as we mark Africa Day.
Thank you very much. Let me thank those who have spoken before me and remind us that interference in Africa started with slavery. When slavery had lost its value, it graduated into colonization. And that is the context in which Berlin must be seen. When the European powers sat in Berlin and divided the continent of Africa into spheres of influence. When colonization had lost its luster through a combination of certain realities and agitation from the continent, we regained our independence. But as John Henry Clark, that great African-American, said, we regained independence by mimicking European governance systems. And he rightly says, no African country will ever succeed on the basis of those systems. After that, the neo-colonial project was instituted. And all of us will remember Kwame Nkrumah's book, Neo-Colonialism, The Last Stage of Imperialism. And he dare says the most dangerous. We are now in a neo-colonial stage when the European powers are at their most diabolical, when the Americans are at their most diabolical. And it's not lost on me that they'll be meeting in Hiroshima next week at the G7. And how do they interfere? They interfere militarily. They ensure that you in the military are trained in Sandhurst, are trained in West Point, so they affect your mind. They interfere diplomatically, sometimes through gunboat diplomacy, and that is why you see sometimes your typical European ambassador treats our heads of states in a condescending manner. They interfere through institutions such as the IMF and the World Bank. They interfere by ensuring that our economic infrastructure is beholden to theirs through dollarization. They interfere through education. They interfere by influencing our processes, by lending us advisors who tell us what to do. The neo-colonial project is alive and well, and it is at its most dangerous, and we Africans must smell the coffee. If we don't, they are going to continue to interfere. How else do they interfere? Through NGOs, Danida, CEDA, UK Aid, US Aid. These are Trojan horses that are introduced into our countries for the purpose of influencing our processes. And they infiltrate our institutions. Right now, if you look at the African Development Bank, look at the shareholding. It's Americans, it's Germans, it's Japanese, it's the French. And the Europeans have done their bit. They also interfere through post-colonial institutions, the Commonwealth of Independent Nations. They are not sovereign states, former French-speaking nations. These are the instruments that they interfere through. And how do we then deal with this situation? We Africans must now begin to recognize, and this was recognized as early as 1963, and the chair of the commission is here. They'll be celebrating 60 years in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. And 60 years ago, on the 24th day of May, Kwame Nkrumah warned us. He said, if we are not united, they are going to interfere with us militarily. They are going to interfere with our economy. They are going to interfere with our agriculture. They are going to interfere with our health. Our duty, and I hope that when African heads of states and government meet in Addis next week, it will not be another jamboree at which pro forma speeches are read. I hope it will be an occasion to give meaning to Africa Agenda 2063. I hope it will be an occasion to give meaning to Africa Continental Free Trade Area. I hope it will be an occasion to revitalize the Malabo Declaration, the Maputo Declaration, the Yamoussoukro Declaration. In other words, we Africans, as I conclude, we Africans must stop operating in silos. Rwanda alone will not confront them. Burundi alone will not confront them. But if we go through the regional bodies and ultimately the African Union, we may indeed succeed in putting away this bulwark. And remember, it is no longer just Europe. There is a new scramble for Africa. The Chinese are here. The Turks are here. The Qataris are here. All of them are coming back. And the military bases that you see here is telling you that if you don't behave, we are going to use force. Sometimes I wish, and I'm saying this seriously, that we too had a nuclear weapon, because that is what Europe and America understands. The impact of European and American and Russian and Chinese interference is a raw wound. It is not something that is in the past. It is something that is happening as we speak. And therefore, when we speak to it, we are speaking to it to warn ourselves of the reality. When we speak about the Danidas and the NGOs, these are bodies whose raison d'etre is to ensure that we remain in a perpetual state of begging. That is what we are doing, to warn ourselves. And we are not for one minute saying that we will shut ourselves out from the rest of the world. What we are saying is that we must define how we engage with the whole world. And we are saying that as individual countries, we are weak, and the rest of the world wants to operate and to deal with us in our weak state. The United States of America dealing with Rwanda on second-hand clothing. Rwanda cannot resist them. Burundi cannot. Kenya cannot. Uganda cannot. But if we are East Africa with a population of 300 million, we can. If we are SADC, we can. If we are ECOWAS, we can. So this is what we are saying. And we are saying further that going forward, we must also recognize our internal weaknesses. And what is our weaknesses? Chinua Achebe said it very well. The problem of Africa is simply and squarely one of political leadership. The rank of many political leaders in Africa are thieves. Let's call them by their name. They are thieves. They are individuals who are not interested in the interest of this country, And as long as we continue electing such individuals into positions of power across Africa, they are going to be manipulated. What then is the responsibility of the citizenry? The responsibility of the citizenry is to make demands. The chairman here, I hope he has received the several letters that I've written to him. I've written several letters to his organization, talking about the role of the African Union in peacemaking. I wrote to the chairman only last week about the situation in Sudan, saying we must solve our own problems. And I want to see a crusading African Union, so that it's not the Americans and the Saudi Arabians who are summoning them to Jeddah. It should be in Addis Ababa. In a nutshell, Joe, what I'm saying is that we have a responsibility to ourselves, both at the leadership level and at levels of the civic society. We must be engaged in a positive manner, and we must keep on shouting without being diplomatic, because diplomacy is lulling us into a false sense of security. And lastly, I want to say this. When foreign powers come, we must always be reminded of these goodies that they bring to us. It used to be said of the Trojan War that even when the Greeks bear gift, they do not mean well. They never mean well. And the sooner we say it, recognizing the external threat, recognizing the domestic weaknesses, the safer we are. Right now, as I conclude, there is a group of experts going around East Africa, collecting views about the constitution of East Africa. I've just written to them this morning. They are leaving Kenya. If you ask 10 Kenyans, possibly only one knows they are in Kenya. Then they will be going to Burundi. If you ask your typical African about Africa Agenda 2063, out of 10, if two know about Africa Agenda 2063, you'll be lucky. If you ask them about the Africa Continental Free Trade Area 10, if two know, you'll be lucky. In other words, we are not doing well. And I'm going to be blunt at these functions. If you ask the chair of the African Union, who funds the African Union, possibly 60% of the budget is externally funded. He who pays the piper calls the tune.
Mama Africa. the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit, but my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? It is all I ever have. Redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our mind. War, have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop at the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Yes, some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? It's all I ever have. Redemption songs, all I ever have. Redemption songs, songs of freedom, songs of freedom.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Allow me to welcome you all to our Africa Day virtual town hall. My name is Patience Okanti, and I'm honored to be one of the hosts alongside Dr. Quest for today's event. I reside here in Vancouver with my family and have been working within the healthcare for over 15 years. I also have had the pleasure of working with Dr. Quest on a number of different social events over the years. We hope that you enjoy all the hard work and dedication that has gone into today's event. We are here to commemorate, celebrate, as well as reflect Africa's destiny, her achievements, challenges, shortcomings, and aspirations. A few housekeeping items first. This event is being recorded. If you do not want to be recorded, you may leave now. This event is also simultaneously live streamed on Facebook. You may ask your friends and family to watch the Facebook live feed. As you can see, everyone is muted. This will continue until the question and answer section, when everyone desiring to speak must raise their hands using the reaction buttons at the bottom of the screen. Also, there will be an African heritage quiz, which will be based on a video documentary we will be screening later on after the speeches. Please watch the video attentively, as the winners will be given prizes. The quiz will be taken in groups. We will create breakout rooms and randomly assign participants. Each breakout room will take the quiz and appoint a member as a spokesperson to report their answers. After the breakout session, the winning group will be giving prizes, which involves being inducted into the African Canadian Education Fund, ACEF, Hall of Benefactors on our website. The ACEF Hall of Benefactors is reserved for individuals and groups who contribute in substantial ways to the intellectual, social, cultural, and financial well-being of our people locally and globally.
We have always been here. We are the Indigenous people of these lands, the First Peoples. Canada is Indigenous land. Our roots are deep all across this country. We have been here for thousands of years. Indigenous people include First Nations, Inuit, and Métis. There are over 600 distinct Indigenous communities all across these lands. There are over 60 different Indigenous languages.
Lillian Elias, Inu Wing Min, Maunga Kai Kavit Kuwea Huktunga, Mani Rutikran Kuwea Naktuakun Ililu.
White Haskell Held Gulimlimt Bijiap.
Sego se wego are the ones the young gats. Ganyuka Hagan, Wago Pontoro, that no at nowhere and never get their lord. Wagatanuni jigar isis. What when you burlado jinohora learning at Dunkwane Ganada?
Nina Michelle Sliboy de Luisi. Atleawi unamai. Well, die, bitter die or Irish Lassis Hamo de Luisi, Canada.
Tansena Wakumaganak, Madeline is Nagasun, Sakaski Square to Tehkawin, Sakatawaku Tehnia.
Indigenous communities are richly diverse. We have our own languages, belief systems, laws, but we also have common traditions. We share the understanding that we are connected to each other and all life on Earth. It's important to give back and never take too much. Our laws are based upon ancient knowledge of how to live in balance with the Earth and make decisions that benefit all living things, past, present and future. We are caretakers of our lands. In the 1500s, European settlers came here with very different values. They said our lands were free for the taking, and they took over most of our lands and resources. Ignoring our laws and our systems of governance, the newcomers said they were the founders and they put themselves in charge of the new government. They imposed laws such as the Indian Act and reserve system, which limited our rights and excluded us from the new society being built on our lands. They tried to change who we are as Indigenous people. For many years, important ceremonies like the potlatch and Sundance were made illegal. The Canadian government created the residential school system run by churches from the 1800s until 1996. Over 150,000 Indigenous children were forcibly removed from their families and taken to residential schools where they were forbidden to speak their languages and practice their cultures. Abuse and mistreatment were very common. Today, Canada still has much healing to do in order to have equality and justice for Indigenous people. For example, almost half of all children in the foster care system are Indigenous. Over 150 Indigenous communities in Canada don't have clean water to drink. We are still working to protect our homelands and uphold our laws. Canada has apologized for the wrongs of the residential school system. There is a movement to build better relationships and to recognize that Canada was built upon the lands and resources of the First Peoples. We have survived. We are strong and resilient. We are reclaiming control of our education and restoring our languages. We are the fastest growing and youngest population in Canada. These will always be our homelands. Our lands are our history and our future. The land is us. The land is our language.
Keep the words that we've always had. It's the lives inside.
We share this land. Let's work together to heal the wrongs of our country and build a bright future for all.
And I would like to welcome you to Canada.
I welcome you to Canada. I'm very glad that you chose this country to be your new homeland. I hope that we will meet one day as friends. Malalia.
At this time, I would like to ask Dr. Charles Quest to give us our opening address. Dr. Quest?
Yeah. All right, okay. So, good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be. Comrades, compatriots, fellow Pan-Africanists, the global Africanist, friends, ladies and gentlemen, I greet you in the sacred names of our ancestors across the global African landscape who toiled, labored, sweated, and sacrificed their lives in the anti-slavery, anti-racist, anti-oppression, and anti-colonial struggles so we may live. May I ask for a minute's silence in their hallowed memories? A minute's silence, please. May their souls rest in eternal peace. As we commemorate 60 years of the Organization of African Unity, the progeny of the African Union, it is only fitting and proper to doff our hats to one person, Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah of Africa. My speech is based largely on the axioms of Kwame Nkrumah, which contains excerpts from his books and speeches on Pan-Africanism, global African unity, and world peace. Nkrumah's words of wisdom, as contained in axioms, reveal the extent of his commitment to, unflagging zeal, and unquenchable optimism in the African cause and world peace. Nkrumah's words of wisdom or Nkrumah's axioms should serve as a constant reminder of and a signpost to us, our friends of Africa everywhere, as we chart our way through the 21st century. Kwame Nkrumah, the visionary Pan-Africanist who dreamed of a united, prosperous Africa, was a man of foresight. He had a noble vision for Africa and the Black race. He saw the metropolises of Africa becoming the headquarters of science, technology, and medicine. He saw in Africa a giant hypnotized and rendered dormant by years of foreign tutelage and exploitation. And he sought to awaken this giant. But time and his contemporaries were not on his side. He seemed to have moved ahead of his time. And as the celebrated British historian Basil Davidson rightly put it, Nkrumah lived ahead of his time. It will be years to come when people will come to read about his works and wonder to themselves why such a man should live at such a time. But it is not surprising, therefore, that the British Broadcasting Corporation listless a few years ago named this man, that is Nkrumah, Africa's man of the millennium. Born into a humble Smith family in Nkrofu, in the western region of the then British colony of the Gold Coast, now Ghana, Nkrumah was to become one of the most illustrious makers of modern Africa, and perhaps the most ardent, consistent advocate of the unity of the Black race after Marcus Garvey. His single-minded desire to make Africa the proud home of all people of African descent dispersed around the world brought him to work together with the leaders and architects of the Pan-Africanist movement, including W.B. Du Bois of the United States of Africa, the United States of America, yes, one day the United States of Africa will come to be. George Padmore of Trinidad, Nnamdi Azikiwe of Nigeria, Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya, and many, many others. Nkrumah was one of the key organizers of the historic fifth Pan-African Africanist Congress in Manchester 78 years ago, He was one of the key organizers of the historic Pan-Africanist Congress in Manchester 78 years ago, a Congress which proved decisive in the struggle against foreign rule in Africa and racial oppression in the West, and demonstrated a remarkable unity between continental Africans and Africans in the diaspora. Nkrumah did not only bring Pan-Africanism to his natural home when he returned to the Gold Coast after his sojourn in America and England to lead the independence movement. He also established and sustained till the end of his regime a link between the continent and the diaspora. He made Padmore his advisor and invited the grand old man of Pan-Africanism, Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, to live his last days in Ghana. In Africa, Nkrumah attempted to form the kernel of his pet dream, the United States of Africa, with Sékou Touré of Guinea, Modibo Keita of Mali, and Patrice Lumumba of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Without doubt, Nkrumah ranks among the greatest political figures of the 20th century, an indefatigable champion of world peace, advocate and spokesman of the non-aligned movement. It was only ironic that his government was overthrown in a violent CIA masterminded coup while he was on his way to Hanoi to negotiate a peaceful settlement of the war in Vietnam. Nkrumah's revolutionary and Pan-Africanist ideas swept across the entire continent, from Algeria to Zimbabwe, from Casablanca to Cape Town. Consistent with his Independence Day declaration that the independence of Ghana was meaningless unless it was linked with the total liberation of the entire African continent, Nkrumah trained African liberation fighters, financed their movements, and empowered them to dislodge colonial rule from their territories. All of Nkrumah's adult life was devoted to one and only one passion, the liberation and unity of the African race. He lived, dreamed, and died for this ideal. His passion and the quest for a continental union government prompted his detractors and enemies to brand him a dreamer, a megalomaniac, an African Don Quixote. But judging from the parlous state of the continent's desperate, dispirited, non-viable 54 countries today, Nkrumah's call for the formation of a United States of Africa government was a wise one, if brazen at the time. The largely ineffective African Union is a testimony to Nkrumah's warning that only a continental government of political and economic unity could save the continent from the encircling gloom spawned by enraging intestine wars, famine, and disease. Nkrumah argued rather forcefully that it was only a federal state of Africa based on a common market, a common currency, a unified army, an African high command, he called it, and a common foreign policy could provide the launching pad for not only a massive reconstruction and modernization of the continent, but also optimize Africa's efforts to find its rightful place in the international arena and effectively checkmate internal conflict, fend off superpower interference, predatory and imperialistic wars. But Nkrumah's tragedy was probably that he came to power in the heat of the Cold War, a period when the bipolar East-West ideological confrontation made leaders like Nkrumah sacrificial lambs on the altar of superpower chauvinism. Cold War politics broached no homegrown nationalists and patriots. It did not forgive leaders who refused to worship the gods of Soviet communism or American capitalism. I'd like to leave you with these quotes from Nkrumah's book, The Axioms of Nkrumah. Quote, if we do not formulate plans for unity and take steps to to form a political union. We'll be fighting and warring among ourselves with imperialists and colonialists standing behind the screen and pulling vicious wires to make us cut each other's throats for the sake of their diabolical purposes in Africa, unquote. Quote, if the Sahara Desert divided us in the past, today it must unite us, unquote. Quote, the close links forged between continental Africans and peoples of African descent over half a century of common struggle must continue to inspire and strengthen us. For although the outward forms of our struggles may change, it remains in essence the same, a fight to death against oppression, racism, and exploitation. And finally, Africa's problems are not a frozen entity whereby we say, let us solve this problem today, put it aside, and move on to solve the next one tomorrow. It will be too late. Africa must unite. Africa must unite. Africa must unite. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Quest. We are going to be having some goodwill messages from some of the members that have joined us today. I would like to call on MLA Honorable Andrew Mercier to give his goodwill message.
Yes, thank you so much. And I want to start just by saying, I'll introduce myself. I'm Andrew Mercier. I'm the MLA for Langley and the Minister of State for Workforce Development. I'm currently in my constituency in Langley on the traditional territory of the Kwantlen, Catesy, Matsqui, and Semiahmoo First Nations. And I want to thank Dr. Quest and I want to thank you, Patience, for organizing the event today. It's really awesome to hear the passionate words of Dr. Quest. And I want to give a big shout out to the Africa Canada Education Foundation, and in particular, for all of the work on anti-racism you're doing. And I'm going to mention that just in a second. But I just want to say, it's no secret to anybody here, Canada's changing, British Columbia's changing. We're going through a massive demographic shift right now, where the baby boom generation is retiring and population growth is being predominantly made up now by immigration. And I see it in my own community every day. The new Canadians is a growing portion of the population, and in particular, people from Pan-African descent is a huge portion of the population that is now growing in British Columbia. And we need to make sure that we're there to brace that diversity and to brace inclusivity and multiculturalism, while also making sure that we're, in the words I think Dr. Quest just used, fighting against the oppression and racism that can come along with that. And that's why I'm proud of the work we're doing with the Africa Canada Education Foundation. We've introduced an Anti-Racism Data Act in 2022. And we're going to be introducing new legislation in 2024 to further strengthen that, to make sure that government and government systems are held to account for systemic inequities, discrimination, and oppression. And in order to do that work and to do the consultations and data collection, one of our community partners is the Africa Canada Education Foundation. And I can say it's government bringing the legislation forward, but that is on the backs of the hard work of all of the activists and all of the organizations that are on the ground doing the real work. And so I want to give a big shout out to the team for all of that, because it is incredibly important work. And I think that oftentimes it is thankless. And I'll just say a quick word as well, that, you know, I have met so many people over the course of my time in elected life and in my career before that, that come from across the world to Canada and bring international credentials with them. The number of engineers I've talked to and healthcare workers from Africa or from Southeast Asia or from all over the place who don't have their credentials recognized here is a staggering social justice issue. And our immigration system in this country is set up and holds itself out to newcomers, saying we will prioritize you if you come with an advanced educational background. But what we don't say is that the complex maze of rules towards professional recognition is almost impossible in some instances to navigate. So we are going to be bringing forward this fall some very strong legislation reforming international credential recognition so that folks living here that have the certifications and the skills from their place of origin aren't relegated to a form of second-class citizenship, and that you can live your skills and live your experience. So I'm really excited about that. So I just wanted to say thanks thanks for inviting me. And you know, I bring greetings on behalf of David Eby, the Premier of British Columbia, and the government. And I'm looking forward to a great discussion.
Thank you very much, Andrew Mercier, for taking time to give us your message. We really appreciate it. We have the leaders of the African Heritage / Black History Coalition. I'm just wondering if any of the leaders are here and if you would like to say some words.
I am here and I would like to say some words.
Thank you. Can you please introduce yourself?
I'm Rebecca Juga, Executive Director of African Women Empowerment Society. Thank you all for receiving me to be here. And African Women Empowerment Society, we have a vision to enhance and promote the power of women and girls of African descent. And our mission in this organization is to bring the women all together to create awareness through arts and culture, literacy, conferences, workshops, skill development, entrepreneurship, and financial independence. This will enable them to utilize their skills and talents to improve themselves and their communities. And this helps them. This leads to opportunities available for them to have a successful and fulfilling life. Today, as we celebrate the work of AU in African unity, I would like to make a few comments by saying that we should start by reminding ourselves of our own contributions, which we are doing as Africans in diaspora to enhance this African unity. We want to have a peaceful, prosperous, and a united Africa. Of course, we know that AU has been fighting colonialism, apartheid, and to lead to the progress of Africa, to lead to the prosperity and peace of Africa. And we here in the diaspora want the same thing. So what I want to suggest is that we should become more proactive in the way we support one another as Africans out here. On a situation like this, which Dr. Charles has taken time to organize, we Africans have to come together and support and learn about African unity and be part of it and connect with African organizations, especially the Pan-Africanist movements, to learn and know what to do in order to unite Africa. Another thing I wanted to say, and to that, I say unity is strength. If we keep coming together, this will have a ripple effect. Our being united here will have a ripple effect to back into Africa. The next thing I want to say is that we have to advocate for our children in school, in the schools. If we were listening when we were having the video of land acknowledgement, I want to quote a phrase which I got there. The land is us. The land is our language. So when I say that we have to advocate for our children, it is because our children and us, we are still using the language of the colonial masters. We have a land, but we have no language. So I have seen that there have been suggestions that Swahili language is widely spoken in most parts of Africa, and at least 140 million people speak that language, though just a small quarter of the 1.2 billion Africans. But I am thinking that if we advocate that this language should be put on our Black African curriculum in the school, so that all our children in the school can have one unique language which they can be speaking, like in other than French and English, we are going to have a couple of Africans speaking a unique language and understanding themselves in the nearest 10 years. The last thing I wanted to mention is that I was given only 3 minutes anyway, but I've used one. Having an all-African convention every year in BC to discuss the prosperity and peace in Africa will enable us to achieve a better Africa. When we started in BC, that every year we have all African convention, whether you are a Ghanaian, you are a Ethiopian, whether you are Ugandan, Cameroonian, because of these boundaries that we have, we come as one. And if we can discuss like one voice, we will think politically, we will think economically, we'll see how our voices can come together to develop Africa and make it a united continent. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sister Rebecca, for your words of wisdom. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone, wherever you are. Good day. My name is Eza De Patrick Umera Onopolo. I come from the Igbo peoples of the land called Nigeria. Before I go ahead, I want to say something. The lady that just spoke kind of hit on a lot of things that I wanted to touch on. But I want to start by saying I am the artistic and managing director of African Heritage Music and Dance Society, and it's a name of an organization. I have been in this struggle for our respect and honor amongst the rest of the people around us for over 4 decades. I became a citizen in Canada in 1980. I came here as a student. I'm honored to be residing today on the traditional lands of the Salish peoples here in the Kwantlen people and the Semiamo people. Education, unless it is in one's given language, the language that came from the great one creator, is only there to serve that language in which it is practiced. I know a lot have been, some of us will remember that some people have said that, a lot of people have said that. But for us as Africans, that's a very important factor. We must not forget, in my language, in the language of the Igbo people, what is called God in the English language is called Chineke. And if I translate it in the English language, it means the great spirit that creates, the great creator spirit. And that is how my people and most other Black peoples of Africa, in their own different languages, understood who that great spirit is, and respected and honored that great spirit before the colonizers and the missionaries and the mullahs and the every other religion that came to Africa and made us the only continent in the world that has no religion. And we have been hearing, we have been sitting around and watching our inspired leaders come and make their case and get ignored or get killed, and we do nothing. We are here today. Nigeria had an election, and the whole country is sitting there looking as the government is, you know, as the people that won the election are not being given their rights to rule the country, and the people's rights are being trashed, and nothing is being said. I even see some, you know, some of the past prime ministers are beginning to recognize what is going on there and are going to go to the inauguration. Nothing is happening.
Brother Patrick, anybody? I just want to remind you that you have
the top. Please, let me finish. Let me finish. I will finish, please. I haven't taken as long as the lady that was just there. Do you understand that? Okay, thank you very much. And we, this time for us as Africans, we take what Dr. Adade, by the way, everybody is calling him Quest. I don't know where that is coming from. We have to take time to pay attention, to listen, and to act peacefully in all kinds of peaceful ways. We, in my organization, I'm not going to go into the story of how I started doing it that way through arts and culture, music and dance, which led to all this, us being here today in this country. When I started doing this, there was nobody here. It was in the 80s, early 80s. So we're still doing the same thing. Minister Mercier, I appreciate what you have said and what the government has been doing. But anti-racism thing has been done here so many times by so many different governments. It gets finished and then it goes into the shelves. We can go in and we can find them and bring them up. So unless this is Africa Day, unless we Africans understand that we coming together is the number one thing, wherever we are in our communities here, actually truly coming together and being together and honoring what that means in everything that we do, is the only time when everybody will start recognizing and respecting and appreciating us. Until we are able to come together as a people, yes, a great United States of Africa, for example, and have our one currency, have our one government, have, look, you know, everybody's been said, action is all we need. And one day we will see it. Me, on my part, I am here, very honored to be here in Canada. And I am doing everything and all I can to ensure that the tomorrow people of us here in this land will have something to stand on so that they can live better with all peoples around them. Through arts and culture and music and dance, there's lots of branches, economic and social benefits. Everyone has seen it in this country since the 80s when we started it. I'll give you a little tidbit. Expo 86 was here. I was the one that brought in the music and dance as part of a communication language in this world. I was the one that made it possible for that to be added to Expo 86. And everybody I'm sure if you have the history or you do a research, you'll understand and see what that has done, not just in the economy of this country,
Brother Patrick,
but the world.
This is a global event. We have so many other people waiting to speak.
Okay. Thank you very much.
It's very late in Africa and other parts of the world. So please.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you
for that's why I'm actually putting this
thank
out there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much
for your comments.
And
thank you.
Everybody have a great time. And Africa
thank
will
you.
Be united someday.
Thank you.
God bless you all.
Thank you. At this time, I would like to call Queen Okume Brooke, if she's here, to please give her remarks.
Greetings. Happy Africa Day. Congratulations, King Warrior Brother Charles Adade and our moderator for today, and all those who have already spoken. I give honor and praise. It is time for us to indeed unite, and we have the opportunity of the African Union Day to help us consolidate what we have been all working on. As we speak, the United Nations is meeting with representatives of the Permanent Forum for People of African Descent as we speak. Over 800 people are congregating in New York to discuss the same thing that we are all hoping and wishing for, which is the further liberation of people of African ancestry, the diasporans. Why are we doing this? Why do we need to get together and continue this conversation? It's because the land that we are on, both here in Canada, and the land which we originally come from, back in Africa, needs our support. In resources, in intellectual knowledge, in financial resources, and to show up. And to show up. And showing up means action that connects us back to the continent. And so I am so happy to congratulate you on this program today. My wish, my prayer is that by next year, before we celebrate this, we should actually present a resolution to the Canadian Parliament, that speaks to the role that people of African ancestry have had here in Canada, and that will speak to how we can be positively reconnected with our homelands back in Africa. It will take that for us to really make a meaningful impact. Just like we have the land acknowledgement of the Indigenous people, we should have some kind of either land or people acknowledgement of our contribution to Canada and back in Africa. I represent an organization called the Africa Caribbean Heritage Alliance, ACHA. We are present in the Caribbean, we are present in Africa, and we are also present here in Canada. So I speak to you today coming from Nigeria, through the Caribbean, and from Edmonton, Alberta. Looking forward to more collaborations, and congratulations for a very, very wonderful program today. Thank you. I bow.
Thank you so much, Sister Queen, for your message and your words of encouragement. And hopefully by this time next year, we will have moved forward and made big steps in the direction of unifying Africa and bringing us to the forefront. I would like to now move on to our keynote speaker, Mr. Kwesi Pratt. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters and dear comrades, first of all, I'd like to thank all of you who have worked so hard to put this forum together. This forum that enables us on the continent and outside the continent to begin to examine our past, our today, and also to forge ahead together to build a better tomorrow for African people, wherever they may be. I'd like to salute all of you for the excellent work that we have done. I'd like also to confess that I'm very, very deeply embarrassed by what is happening on the African continent. I'm so very deeply embarrassed by the kind of leaders we have on the African continent today who do not understand our history, who do not care about the miseries that the African people are going through, and who have no ideas which will push us forward. I speak to you from Kwame Nkrumah's Ghana, and I like to inform you that African Liberation Day is no longer a holiday in Ghana, because the current government has decided that African liberation is a thing of the past and that we need not focus on African liberation. As you in the diaspora and some of the continent are paying attention to African Liberation Day and its implications for us, our own government in Ghana has decided that it is not an important event. And that makes me feel very, very deeply embarrassed. That is also an indication of the kind of leaders we have in Africa today. We no longer have the Sekou Tourists. We no longer have the Modibo Keitas. We no longer have the Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumahs, and we no longer have the Nnamdi Azikiwes. Those who made tremendous sacrifices to bring us out of the colonial yoke and who helped us to aspire to a new, united, and prosperous Africa, those leaders no longer exist on our continent. And I think it's our abiding duty to ensure that as we walk into the future, we will get the leaders who think like Nkrumah, we would get the leaders who would act as Modibo Keita. We'll get the leaders who dream of a prosperous Africa. We'll get the leaders who will be imbued with the spirit of Padmore, of Marcus Garvey, and others. African Liberation Day was declared in 1963, primarily to focus attention on the National Liberation Movement, to galvanize the resources of Africa, to defeat classical colonialism, to pave the way for Africans to own their own resources, to exploit these resources for their own benefit, to choose their own leaders, and also to determine their own destiny. But of course, the declaration of African Liberation Day has a long, long history. A history which can be traced to the days of Imhotep and Akinting, who lived maybe 3,000 years before the birth of Christ. This declaration of African Liberation Day in 1963 can also be traced to the 5th Pan-African Congress in Manchester in 1945. We recall that it was at the 5th Pan-African Congress in Manchester that Africans from all over the globe came together and committed themselves fully to the decolonization process across Africa. It was at this conference that the resolution was passed, which said that we have nothing to lose but our chains in the struggle for the total emancipation of the African people. It was at this Congress that all of us as Africans were enjoined to put all of our resources and brain power together to end colonialism, classical colonialism. It was this conference which also gave impetus to the ideas for the unification of Africa, for Africa to have a common currency, for the African people to have a common foreign policy, for Africa to have a common defense strategy, and so on. It was at this conference which also decided that the new Africa, the United States of Africa, should be under the banner of scientific socialism. As a matter of fact, history recognizes that it was the 1945 conference in Manchester, Pan-Africanist Congress in Manchester, which gave impetus to the liberation of the Gold Coast, Nigeria, and many other parts of Africa. That is clear. But we cannot forget in that history that as far back as 1957, newly liberated African countries, independent African countries, met and set the agenda, which led to the All African People's Congress in 1958 in Accra, Ghana. And indeed, it was at this 1958 conference that Patrice Lumumba and many others from different parts of Africa came together and recommitted themselves to this liberation struggle, leading to the acceleration of the independent process across the African continent, and leading ultimately to the 1963 Declaration of Africa Liberation Day. Dear friends and comrades, it's important to remind ourselves that the national liberation struggle in Africa is not over yet. It's important to remind ourselves that as we speak today, Western Sahara, or the Sahari Arab Democratic Republic, is still under colonial occupation. It is still under colonial occupation, and that fact dictates that we need to put together our resources. We need to put together everything that we have to make sure that colonialism is finally uprooted from every part of Africa. It's indeed important also to remind ourselves that all of the islands in the Indian Ocean, African islands in the Indian Ocean, continue to be occupied by the imperialist forces. Diego Geisha today is a military base of the Western Alliance. That also presents a challenge to the African people. It's also important for us to remind ourselves that our commitment to the struggle for the total liberation of Africa is a principled one. It's a principled one. It is not defined by geography, and it is not defined by the color of our skin. It is defined by a principle which asserts that all people everywhere ought to be free from oppression and exploitation. And to this end, we cannot be talking about African liberation without making reference to the continued colonial and apartheid occupation of Palestine. It was indeed Nelson Mandela who said that an end to apartheid is not sufficient until it has included the liberation of Palestine from colonial and apartheid rule. Indeed, we need to remind ourselves of Nkrumah's statement on the eve of Ghana's independence, that the independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it is linked to the total liberation of the African continent. Today, we as proud Africans, today, we as a people committed to the liberation of all people from oppression and exploitation, should say loud and clear that our independence, our fight against racism in all its forms, including apartheid, would not be concluded until every part of the globe has been liberated from the scourge of racism in all its manifestations. That is the challenge before us as African people and as citizens of this world. My brothers and sisters, Africa is going through severe turmoil. I live in West Africa, the largest country in West Africa by population and by size is undoubtedly Nigeria. All of us know about the low-intensity civil war in the Niger Delta. All of us know about the activities of Boko Haram in the Northeast. All of us are keenly aware of the tense situation in eastern Nigeria, and so on. The threat to Nigeria is the threat to the whole of Africa, especially West Africa. Given the fact that Nigeria alone has a population of 230 million people, half the population of the whole of West Africa, and we need to focus attention on how to contribute to achieving stability in Nigeria. Today, as we speak on this platform, we must be keenly aware of the fact that many, many African countries are suffering from what has come to be known as the debt scourge. They say that we owe so much. As a matter of fact, in Ghana, we are having to spend 128% of total national revenue on debt servicing, debt repayment, and public sector emoluments. This is a grave situation that no African country has been able to escape. What brought us here? The fundamental question is, what brought us here? We do know today that all the Francophone African countries have to keep their foreign reserves in the Central Bank of France. In practice, what this has meant is that the Francophone African countries have had to borrow their own money from France and pay interest on their own money. This situation is clearly unacceptable. We cannot continue to run Africa like that. And the time has come when we as Africans have to work for the realization of the dream of Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, and others, Patrice Lumumba and others, for Africa to have its own currency. Africa must have its own currency. Common currency for Africa is an imperative in order to deal with this situation. There's a new phenomenon in Africa today, which has come to be known as the race to the bottom. What is the race to the bottom? Ghana has gold, South Africa has gold, Guinea has gold, Mali has gold. There's gold in many parts of Africa. The imperialist countries and their multinational corporations do not negotiate with us as Africans. They negotiate with us as Ghana, as Nigeria, and so on. So what do? They come to Ghana and they tell us cock and bull stories about the best climate for investment and so on. And they ask for tax holidays. And Ghana agrees to give them 2 years tax holiday. They then move on to Guinea and tell the Guinean authorities that Ghana has given us 2 years tax holiday. If you do better than Ghana, we'll move our investments to Guinea. And Guinea gives them 3 years, and they continue until they get 10 years tax holiday, 15 years tax holiday, and so on. Africa must begin to speak with one voice in all the forums. Africa must begin to have a common strategy for dealing with this situation so that we can end this race to the bottom, which is not in the interest of the African people. My dear brothers and sisters, our struggle, as I said from the beginning, has a long history. Our struggle has its genesis in the transatlantic slave trade. And don't forget that some of the vessels which were brought to Africa to carry us to Europe, to North America, to the Caribbean, as slaves and so on, bore the name Jesus. Don't forget that. Never forget that the vessels which carried us into slavery were named after Jesus. That is significant. Don't forget the papal bull, which was signed by the head of the Catholic Church, authorizing King Afonso of Portugal to capture us as slaves and so on. We must not forget that in the transatlantic slave trade, the strongest, the youngest, the architects, the medical practitioners, the teachers, the artisans, and so on, were those who were captured to serve as beasts of burden. In order to build the foundations of what has become known today as capitalism, in order to build the foundations of the imperialist powers, Africa continues to suffer from the transatlantic slave trade. Africa continues to suffer from the transatlantic slave because of the psychological scars it left on our people. Because it was aimed, quite apart from the exploitation of African labor for free, it also aimed at destroying our self-confidence. We can rise above that and build that new Africa with a new African imbued with the spirit of resistance and imbued with the spirit of struggle to build a better world. We can do it, we must do it, and we will do it. Today, we are being told that if we want to develop, we have to follow the example of the capitalist states. We are told that the only path to development is to copy the United States of America. We are told that the only path of development is copy Germany and so on. My brothers and sisters, I ask you, where today in the world can you find people that you will capture as beasts of burden to work for you for hundreds of years without pay? There is no such place on earth. Where today can we as Africans go and colonize? There is no such place on earth today. So the only option available to us as African people is the building of self-reliant economy, to build an economy on the basis of the resources embedded in our soils, to build an economy on the basis of the development of our manpower, to build a new Africa on the basis of our dreams as African people. Exploitation and oppression is no way to develop. And if exploitation and oppression is no way to develop, then we cannot be copying Germany. We cannot be copying Belgium. And we cannot be copying the United States of Africa, of America. We need to do our own and to move forward. As I listened to the brothers and sisters who spoke earlier, I was impressed by the suggestions they made for the development of an African language. I was so impressed about the connection they established between language and development and so on. That's an important connection. But my brothers and sisters, the connections are many. As Thomas Sankara said, we need to eat our own food. We need to wear our own clothes. We need to speak our own language. We need to develop our own values. We need to do the things that we develop ourselves. A friend of mine recently said that he who has his mouth in another person's kitchen can never be independent and free. So let us take our mouth out of the kitchen of those who colonized us, those who enslaved us, and those who are responsible for today's neo-colonial exploitation. Let us put our mouths in our own kitchen. Let us grow our own food. Let us eat our own food. Let us wear our own clothes. But above all, the fundamental concern must be to build that Africa which is not a victim of oppression, and it is not a victim of exploitation. Let us build that Africa, which itself does not exploit others and oppress others. Let us build our Africa as an Africa which is an integral part of the world, developing values that everybody can copy in order for us to build that new world. That fantastic new world in which the color of a man and a woman's skin is not what determines what they are capable of doing and what they can contribute to our new world. Today, as we discuss African Liberation Day, we cannot ignore the fact that so many foreign military bases are being established on the African soil. In Djibouti, virtually every superpower has a military base in Djibouti. Why? what happens to Kwame Nkrumah's call for an Africa without a bomb? What happened to that call? What happened to the numerous resolutions that were passed by the African Union and the Organization of African Unity, emphasizing the need to remove weapons of mass destruction from the continent of Africa? We have an abiding duty to struggle to remove all foreign military bases on the African soil. If our foreign partners, if those in other parts of the world want to contribute to Africa's development and advancement, we do not need their bombs. We need their tractors to till the land, to plant cassava, to plant rice, to plant yam, to plant tomatoes, to rear our animals, not their bombs. We must make a commitment to build an Africa without a bomb. That is a challenge before us as Africans today. Today, we have to revisit the dreams of our fathers of the independence movement. And what are those dreams? For Africans to own their own resources. Let us own our oil and gas. Let us own our gold and diamonds. Let us own the uranium that is embedded in African soil. Let us own African resources. Let us exploit these resources for the benefit of the African people. Today, we need to make another commitment that the determination of our future and the path to that future will be determined only by Africans. We will learn from the best practices everywhere in the world, but ultimately, Africans must chart their own path to development. As Nkrumah said, the time has come to demonstrate that the African is capable of shaping his or her own destiny. We are not inferior. We have been victims of brutal exploitation. We have been victims of the worst form of racism. But we will rise above that. We will not be victims forever. We shall become masters of our own destiny one day. And that day is approaching very, very fast. We want to build a new, united, and prosperous Africa. We want to build that Africa which lives in a world in which no child will go to bed on an empty stomach. We can build that Africa, we can build that world, and let today's conversation amongst us become the platform from which we will spring forth with ideas, with a new commitment, with new energy to build that world. My brothers and friends and comrades, thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm so, so very grateful to you for allowing me to share on this very distinguished platform of Africans seeking to do something better for the continent. We will succeed by all means and by any means. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pratt, for your message. Thank you for your time and educating us on key points that we need to be reminded of in order to help with the liberation of Africa. We have come far, but there's still much, much more that needs to be done. Thank you for your time and your support. And indeed, we must not forget. Thank you once again. At this time, we are gonna have our African heritage video. Everyone, please pay attention to this video as the quiz that we'll be following will be based on the video.
Oh, I covered the 30 minutes. I was too radical for them.
Our enemies are many, and they stand ready to pounce upon and exploit our every weakness. They prey upon our vanities and flatter us in every kind of way. They tell us that this particular person or that particular country has greater or more favorable potentialities than the other. They do not tell us that we should unite, that we are all as good as we are able to make ourselves once we are free. We want, therefore, to develop our own community and an African personality.
African story in pictures. The story chronicles the struggles of people of African descent across the global African landscape, from Haiti to Canada, from the United Kingdom to the United States, from Angola to Zimbabwe, for emancipation from slavery and colonialism, Jim Crow racism and apartheid. It is a story of pain and suffering, death and destruction, and drowned dreams. It is a story of resistance and endurance, valor and heroism. But this is also a story of sacrifice and resilience, hope and optimism. It is about Africa's brave sons and daughters who led various anti-oppression revolutions and resistances, and the battle for human decency and dignity. This story is dedicated to all the valiant men and women, the unsung heroes and heroines, the nameless and silent masses of Africa, and the diaspora who sweated, toiled, and shed their blood, so we may live and reap the fruits of liberty, even if that liberty is tainted and bitter.
That we must never forget that the colonial power has not left us. We must recognize that he did not go willingly. And if we don't check them, they'll come back again. Thank you.
for African freedoms. I appeal to you in the sacred name of Mother Africa to leave this conference resolved to rededicate yourselves to the task of forming among the political parties in your respective countries a broad united front based upon one common fundamental aim and object, the speedy liberation of your territories. Human dignity experienced by Africans is the direct result of the policy of white supremacy.
His coffin carried by donkey cart in September 1977. His funeral was attended by 20,000 people, including diplomats from 13 countries, his close friend Donald Woods, and members of opposition parties. More could have packed in had security police not set up a cordon around the town. Biko's short life of just 31 years was packed with political activism. There had been deaths in detention before, but the country and world were shocked that someone with a statue of Biko could have died in this fashion.
Our children may learn about the heroes of our past, but our task is to make ourselves architects of the future.
Nothing. The trigger happened, policeman, and that Rockefeller gave word 10 minutes or so, if they don't give up, I think is the way it went, open fire. And one black prisoner came out to speak to the warden. And he said, "You have 10 minutes to surrender. What's your reply? Are we going to come in shooting?" And the black prisoner came out, poetic poem. This didn't happen, but this is what I wrote. He said, "Better far from all I see, to die fighting to be free. What more fitting end could be? Better surely than in some bed where in broken health I'm led, lingering until I'm dead. Better than with prayers and pleas are in the clutch of some disease, wasting slowly by degrees. Better than of heart attack are some dose of drug I lack. Let me die by being black. Better far that I should go, standing here against the foe. Is there sweeter death to know? Better than the bloody stain on some highway where I'm lain, torn by flying glass and pain. Better call in death to come than to die another dumb, muted victim in the slum. Better than of this prison rot, if there's any choice I've got. Kill me here on the spot. Better far my fight to wage now while my blood boils with rage, lest it cool with ancient age. Better violent for us to die than to Uncle Tom and try, making peace just to live a lie. Better now that I say my sooth, I'm gonna die demanding truth while I'm still akin to youth. Better now than later on, now that fear of death is gone, never mind another darn." They opened fire on them, but they died telling it like it was.
Welcome to the Great African Leadership Series, where we feature great inspirational speeches and quotes from African leaders.
Fellow freedom fighters, comrades and friends, long live African freedom fighters. Long live African independence. Long live your struggle. Yeah. And long live African unity. Support. Here is a phenomenon against which all African freedom fighters must be on their guard and resist to the utmost. Even though I appreciate the difficulties facing us, I must admit, I find it strange to watch some of us returning willingly to the colonialist fold. This time, they don't even have the excuse of being forced to subject themselves to foreign domination. It makes one wonder, why so much effort and sacrifice and so many lives were given up to the achievement of independence in the first place, if it can only be so quickly and easily surrendered. We must begin to build immediately our own continental common market. For it is easy for anyone who studies the common market organization closely to realize that the common market is aimed at harnessing the African countries to satisfy the profit loss of the imperialist bloc and to prevent us from following an independent neutralist policy. It is easy to see that the imperialists and the colonialists are determined to retain the African countries in the position of suppliers of cheap raw materials. If we do not resist this threat, and if we throw in our lot with the common market, we shall doom the economy of Africa to a state of perpetual subjection to the economy of Western Europe. This will, of course, hinder the industrialization of our young African states, It is impossible to think of economic development and national independence without possessing an unfettered capacity for maintaining a strong industrial power. The activities of the common market are therefore fraught with dangerous political and economic consequences for the independent African states. The organization constitutes an attempt to replace the old system of colonial exploitation by a new system of collective colonialism, which will be stronger and more dangerous than the old evils we are striving to liquidate from our continent. This is another reason why we should come together in a unified African economic plan, which, operating on a continental scale, can make a solid attack on the imperialist domination in Africa. We should, without delay, aim at the creation of a joint African military command. There is little wisdom in our present separate effort to build up and maintain defense forces, which, in any case, would be ineffective in a major world conflict. If we examine this problem realistically, we would ask, which single African state could protect itself against an imperialist aggressor? And how much more difficult this would be when some states are allowing the imperialists to maintain bases on their territories. I have already referred to the military forces which South Africa is raising and the danger it poses for the new African states and the struggle of those still in chains. Only our unity can provide us with anything like adequate protection. Those problems can best be met within a unified Africa. And it should be possible in the higher reaches of our endeavor to devise a constitutional structure which will secure the objectives I have outlined and yet preserve the sovereignty of each of the countries joining the Union. Countries within the Union will naturally maintain their own constitutions, continue to use their own national emblems and national anthems and other symbols and paraphernalia of sovereignty. Regional associations and territorial groupings can only be other forms of balkanization unless they are conceived within the framework of a continental union. There are existing models which we can modify or adapt to our pattern. The United States of America, the Soviet Union, India and China have proved the efficacy of unions embracing large stretches of land and population. Long live African freedom fighters. Long live African independence. Yeah. Long live your struggle. Yeah. And long live African unity.
I hope that everybody paid attention to the videos and all the information that was on there. So I'll hand it over to Dr. Q before he gives you the quiz. Dr. Quest?
All right. Thank you so much. Great MC, the best MC of the century.
Thank you, Dr. Q.
You're doing so well. And thank you, everybody. We are going to have a quiz. I'll be posting the questions, the quiz. You're going to try to answer the questions, right? Take the quiz. The winners, okay, is going to be given a prize, but this is not going to be a physical prize because you are all over the place, all right? So we have decided to create what we call It's called a hall of benefactors. A hall of benefactors. And this hall is going to be on our website, and our social media, where anyone or any group who contributes in a substantial way to the intellectual, sociocultural, economic or financial development of Africa, all right, will be inducted into this hall of benefactors. Okay, so it is a big project and an ambitious one. And I hope you're all going to take it seriously, because you are going to be all over the world, right? Helping the African cause. Question number one. He was voted Africa's Man of the Millennium by the British Broadcasting Corporation Africa Listeners. A, Nelson Mandela. B, Steve Biko. C, Kwame Nkrumah. D, Patrice Lumumba. The question again. He was voted Africa's Man of the Millennium by BBC Africa Listeners. Nelson Mandela. A, that is A, Nelson Mandela. B, Steve Biko. C, Kwame Nkrumah. D, Patrice Lumumba. The second question. What was the original name for Black History Month? A, Black History Day. C, Emancipation Day. B, Emancipation Day, yes. C, Negro History Week. D, African Liberation Week. I'll repeat. Question number two. What was the original name for Black History Month? A, Black History Day. B, Emancipation Day. C, Negro History Week. And D, African Liberation Week. Question number three. Who founded Black History Month? A, Abraham Lincoln. B, Martin Luther King Jr. C, Carter G. Woodson. And D, Malcolm X. Question number three again. Who founded Black History Month? A, Abraham Lincoln. B, Martin Luther King Jr. C, Carter G. Woodson. And D, Malcolm X. Question number four. This African freedom fighter led Congo to independence and was jailed and assassinated with the complicity of Western governments. A, Patrice Lumumba. B, Steve Biko. C, Nelson Mandela. And D, Sekou Toure. Question number four again. This African freedom fighter led Congo to independence and was jailed and assassinated with the complicity of Western governments. A, Patrice Lumumba. B, Steve Biko. C, Nelson Mandela. And D, Sekou Toure. Question number five. He was jailed for 27 years for fighting against apartheid in South Africa. A, Nelson Mandela. B, Nnamdi Azikiwe. C, Obafemi Awolowo. D, Amilcar Cabral. number six. Okay, this person created the first racially integrated school in Canada and was the first female newspaper publisher to establish a newspaper, the Provincial Freeman, in Windsor, Ontario. A, Mary Ann Shard. B, Ann Coles. C, Jean Augustine. And D, Mikhail Jean. All right, let me repeat. So this person created the first racially integrated school in Canada and was the first female newspaper publisher to establish a newspaper, the Provincial Freeman in Windsor, Ontario. A, Mary Ann Shard. C, Ann Coles. B, Ann Coles. C, Jean Augustine. And D, Mikhail Jean. Number seven. He was a Black governor of British Columbia. A, Sir James Douglas. B, Lincoln Alexander. C, Carter G. Woodson. And D, Malcolm X. Number eight. This person was Canada's first Black cabinet minister in the federal government. A, Carter G. Woodson. B, Malcolm X. C, Sir James Douglas. And D, Lincoln Alexander. Number eight again. He, or this person, was Canada's first Black cabinet minister in the federal government. A, Carter G. Woodson. B, Malcolm X. C, Sir James Douglas. And D, Lincoln Alexander. Number nine. She was the first African-Canadian female to be appointed to the Senate by Prime Minister Trudeau in 1984. A, Mary Ann Shard. B, Ann Coles. C, Jean Augustine. And D, Rosemary Brown. I beg your pardon. Let me take that again. Number nine, she was the first African Canadian female to be appointed to the Senate by Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Oh, I beg your pardon, not Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau. Forgive me. Pierre Trudeau, Justin's father, in 1984. A, Mary Ann Shard. B, Ann Coles. C, Jean Augustine. And D, Rosemary Brown. Number 10, born in Haiti, she was the 27th Governor General of Canada, the third woman and the second immigrant to assume the position. A, Mikhail Jean. B, Ann Coles. C, Jean Augustine. I have only three options here. So let me repeat the question. Born in Haiti, she was the 27th Governor General of Canada, the third woman and the second immigrant to assume the position? A, Mikhail Jean, B, Ankus, and C, Jean Augustine. Continue with the program till its logical end. I'm going to ask our sister Rebecca Dugar to give the vote of thanks. After the vote of thanks, we're going to have a poetry session, and then we're going to, if Reverend Nungu is here, she's going to give us the closing prayer. All right. So, our dear sister, could you give the vote of thanks, and then we're going to play the poetry videos.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. It has been such an honor to be part of this wonderful event. On behalf of the organizers, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our esteemed guest, Honorable Andrew Messier, Member of Parliament, Member of the Legislative Assembly of British Columbia, our keynote speaker, Kwasi Pratt, editor, Inside Newspaper, and director of Pan-African TV, Ghana, Africa, and King Omar Jofu of Uganda. Thank you for coming. My sincere thanks to all members of the consortium who are here today, and a wide round applause. And thanks to all the participants who made the event a memorable one. Finally, I would like to thank all of you present here today for making the time to be with us and helping us to make this event a grand success. Long live African unity. God bless you all.
Thank you, my dear sister. Thank you so very much indeed. Our able background assistant, Tyrell, is going to play some videos of poetry.
I know your real name. You proclaimed you're the law of karma, the author of the golden rule, the good and evil supreme arbiter. You whispered into my tender ears when I was but a suckling, Lil Kwabena. Sow the seeds of goodness and reap the sweet fruits of blessing. You sang me to sleep with your lullaby, Lil Kwabena, never forget. What goes around, comes around. And I accepted without drama, I know this cordon sound. You preached to me, Little Kwabena, bad deeds return wrath and pestilence. I welcomed your solemn sermon in silence. Yet, many have I witnessed labor to shower kindness and charity. But alas, they reap the bitter fruits of recrimination and hostility. Many have I seen chasten fellow humans and bring stone of pain and anguish. Yet, they flourish as though without blemish. And the kind-hearted you left to perish. Don't tell me your wheels grind slow, because I will be 6 feet below. Don't tell me the rewards for good deeds I will reap someday, because I will be 6 feet under before that day. Don't tell me hellfire awaits the wicked one day, because the wicked cares less about your prophetic day. Don't tell me my misfortune is a blessing in disguise, because a blessing in disguise is a curse in demise. Don't tell me you are blind, because your blindness is selectively color-sensitive and color-coded in your mind. Because in your blindness you witnessed in complicit reticence the trilogy of the Maafa slavery, colonialism, and post-colonial neocolonialism. Because in your color blindness you witnessed in supine silence white supremacists' atrocities, apartheid, Jim Crow Juneteenth, Sharpeville, Soweto. Because in your color-sensitive blindness, you witness in frigid carelessness the cold-blooded murder of Lumumba, Biko, Floyd. And legions you watched in abandoned callousness to perish in anguish in your heartless limbo. Yes, Justice, I know your real name. I know your actual name. Your name is Unjustice. Poetry by Dr. Charles Quist Adade, May 20. Musings of the Son of the Global Village. I am the son of the global village. I am a complex of complexities. In the heart of complexities, I am one and many things. Yet I am nothing. I am a hybrid of hybridities. Yet I am who I am. Yet still, I am the I am of complexities. Son of the global village, I have planted my feet firmly in the soil of my motherland and let my eyes to restlessly roam the global village. I see breathtaking beauty, but also I see ugly scars dotting the village landscape. I breathe the air of freedom, creativity, self-actualization. Yet I gasp in airless oppression, alienation, culturecide. I savor the air of renewal, replenishment. Yet I gasp in the air of suffocating toxicities. I see harvest of plentitude. Yet I see harvest of starvitude, lentitude. I see seasons of yet I see cycles of pillage. I am the son of the global village. But whose village? Am I Akan, Ga Adangbe, Ghanaian, Canadian? Written by Dr. Charles Quist Adade. Narrated by Daniel Akinshola.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to our very phenomenal Global Town Hall, Africa Day Global Town Hall. The lessons learned are invaluable. The speeches, very, very powerful. We'll be doing these events, you know, occasionally, you know, to help to educate one another, ourselves and others, about the need for us to forge ahead, you know, to create the needed bridges, okay? Economic, political, sociocultural bridges between continental Africans and Africans in the diaspora, because our destiny is one destiny and it's tied together. Our destiny is the continent. And as the great Peter Tosh said, no matter where you were born, right? Once you are a Black man, you are an African, right? We all share the same destiny. No African will walk free, proud, chest up, okay, until the continent of Africa is liberated economically, and I dare say politically. We won independence, you know, 60 years plus years ago, but you all will agree with me that politically, we are not that free, okay? So let us meet again another time and share ideas, all right? We always say that, oh, the future belongs to the youth. That is so true. But remember, the current leaders were the youth. the current leaders of Africa were the youth of yesteryears. So it's not just, you know, being young or old that can bring about the needed transformation. Is the mindset, all right? The decolonized mindset that would help us to liberate our continent. The needed, liberated, emancipated mindset, as the great Bob Marley said, emancipation from mental slavery. And I might even add neo-colonial slavery, all right? Because the struggle is not a one-time thing. Our oppression is not one-time thing. It's a dynamic, ongoing, systematic and systemic process. And the fight must not be a one-time thing. It must be an ongoing process. So I leave you with a quotation from Frantz Fanon. He said, every generation must discover, out of obscurity, must discover its destiny or its mission, and either betray it or realize it or fulfill it. The question that I leave with you is, have we discovered our mission? And are we going to fulfill it or betray it? Thank you so very much indeed. Asante sana. God bless all of you. Yeah, the floor is open. If you have anything to say, please feel free to share your nuggets of wisdom. Or if you have any questions, you know, to ask, especially to our powerful, you know, keynote speaker, Mr. Kwesi Pratt. If you have any questions to ask him, please feel free to do so. Oh, Mama Kombi, if you're here, you were going to say something, Mama Kombi.
Hi, everyone. This is Mama Kombi. I'm happy to have been part of this journey. I was away in Africa, but when I came back, I'm happy that Dr. Charles also included me in what is happening today. Mine is to go back and look at exactly what everybody contributed to. And the good part of it came from all of you who spoke. And I quoted a few things here for us to go to take with us. I quoted freedom. Freedom for us is huge. I quoted something called unity. Unity is big. I also looked at what Kwame Nkrumah told us, his dream. And this is the dream that should drive us. We should not wait for tomorrow. All these little things we are doing, they're making us more stronger, looking behind what the ancestors left us to do. When we go back and look at where the problem started, to us in North America, we have always looked at the transatlantic slave trade. That was where, like I would say, we should most times focus and what came with it. What came with it, one of them is the division of Africa, putting the boundaries, a brother in Uganda and another brother in Kenya, another brother in one world, the other brother is in the other world. That was not what an African person wanted to see. So with those boundaries, it went ahead dividing us further. We've been divided. When we try to come together and do something as one, something will come in and say, we are not good enough. So let's look back and see that division is not among us. And let's work together as always as a people. I have always looked back at what Haiti as a country, slaves who moved to Haiti, and like odds and hardships, it was the first country to get independence. And that has been my love for Black people, starting from that country. I go back to the speaker, Prad, who really spoke widely about the challenges we face, like discrimination and racism. The challenges with the African countries face with France. Like he said something and it touched my heart, that why are we paying for our own money? The money that we gave, we are still asking to be paid. It is something, it's something that he said, but it touched me because I see that pain. The only thing that we don't have is maybe a voice. How can we come together as a people and start pushing these two things? The African countries that French is still pushing to pay them. The second thing that he said was the countries that have military bases in Africa. Let's just come together again and do something that we go to United Nations meetings and say, we want all military bases in Africa to be removed because we don't want the bombs. We want peace. We want water. We want education. We want healthcare. We want poverty to go, but we don't want these military bases in our countries. So those are the two very main things that I will talk to Dr. Quist to see what is it that we can start to talk about and start pushing for somebody somewhere to listen to us. The other thing is he talked of building the new economy. He talked of building the new Africa. This is what we are doing, is we are on the way there, but we need to do more than that. Our languages, our culture, our food, and developing our own values. These are the things that the United Nations gave us, and it's ending next year, the decade for the people of African descent. So if we pushed these things and said, at the end of 10 years that we were given, these are the things that we have come up with, mm-hmm. and we want somebody to listen to us. And this is, we want it to be done. Like, I'm so happy with my other brothers and sisters that we have pushed the government of Canada to recognize that racism is real, racism lives, racism has been and is, and that is when they developed that law that came in June. So let's push more. I'm so sorry that I'm taking a lot of your time, but I think it was important that I had to say something. And thank you for giving me this chance. And God bless you. Asante sana.
Thank you, Mama Kombi, our sister and mama, for that insightful, inspirational contribution. Again, I'd like to thank you for your participation in our Africa Day Global Town Hall. The lessons have been valuable or priceless. Your presence, you know, is very much appreciated. It is hoped that you carry the message far and in far afield, right? And share, you know, the little conversations or the micro interactions that we have for our people, you know, sharing some of the things that we do here, all add up, all right, to educate us, you know, conscientize us, and our children to take up the mantle that was passed on by the early freedom fighters, the Nkrumahs, the Lumumbas, the Sankaras, the Bikos, the Mandelas, right? And so we can continue the battle for the total emancipation of our people, economically, especially now. All right, thank you again, and God bless all of you. We are going to end the session now. All right, so let's end here. Good night, everybody. Those in East Africa, West Africa, Central Africa, Canada, here in Western Canada, it's only 2:43 p.m., still in the afternoon.